Parshat Ra'eh, I want you to listen to some stories and ask yourself, what is going on in these stories? What are they trying to tell us? Here we are, three rabbis. Number one, Rabbi Abba, used to bind money in his scarf, sling it on his back and place it at the disposal of the poor. It would sort of creep up on him from the back and take what they needed from his bag. Number two, Ma'ukba, had a poor man in his neighborhood into whose door he used to throw 4 coins every day. Once the poor man said, I really want to see who actually gives me all this money. That day, Ma'ukba happened to be studying late in the Beit Midrash and his wife was coming home with him. And the poor man saw them moving towards the door, just ready to put some money by the door, as Ma'ukba always used to do. And they fled from him and they hid. And the Gemara asks, why did they do this? Because it is taught, rather throw yourself into a fiery furnace than publicly put anyone to shame, than publicly shame somebody by having to receive tzedakah. And finally, we have a Rabbi Yonah, who saw a man of good family who'd lost his money. He was once quite well off. He'd lost all his money and he was ashamed to accept charity. And Rabbi Yonah went to him and said, I heard that an inheritance has come your way. Maybe the lawyers haven't told you this, but I happen to know you're about to inherit a great deal of money. So here's an article of some value. Sell it and use the proceeds. And when your inheritance comes in, then you can give me back the money. So the poor man accepted the gift and Rabbi Yonah said, now you don't have to repay me, it's yours. Because he knew the man wouldn't accept it as a gift, so he gave it to him as a loan and then told him it was a gift. What is happening here in all these stories? What is happening is we are learning Hilchot Tzedakah, the laws of Tzedakah, which are based on this week's parasha, which says if there's anyone poor among your fellow Israelites in any of the towns that the Lord your God is giving you, don't be hard-hearted or tight-fisted towards them. Rather be open-handed and freely lend them whatever they need. Give generously to them. Do so without a grudging heart, because then God will bless you in all you do. There will always be poor people in the land. Therefore, I command you to be open-handed towards your fellow Israelites who are poor and needy in your land. So, what we have here is the biblical source of Hilchot Tzedakah. And what makes Tzedakah unique, I think, is a number of things. But first and foremost is the very concept itself, Tzedakah. Normally that's translated in English as charity. However, Tzedakah does not mean charity because there is a halakha kofin al Tzedakah. That if somebody is judged not to give enough money to tzedakah, a Beit Din may force him to give. Charity is always voluntary, but tzedakah is compulsory and can be enforced in a Jewish court of law according to halakha. And that means that tzedakah has no English word that quite corresponds to it. The nearest we have in English is the phrase social justice. So the first thing is tzedakah is obligatory and not just voluntary like charity. But the second is what is implicit in all the stories that I gave you, which is the psychology of poverty. Poverty doesn't just mean that materially we're unable to support ourselves. It also means psychologically we lose a basic element of human dignity. And therefore, the halachot of tzedakah concern not only how much to give, but how to give. Always give in a such a way that doesn't humiliate anyone. So Rabbi Abba used to carry his throw his tzedakah money in a bag behind his back so that he would never see who he was giving to. And the recipient knew that he couldn't see who he was giving to. Ma'ukba used secretly to put these coins in the poor man's doorway so that the poor man didn't know who he was receiving from. And Rabbi Yonah gave this money to the man as a loan and then said, no, you keep it, you don't need to repay me. Again, because he knew that the person was too embarrassed to accept tzedakah, and therefore he gave it to him under this ruse of it being a loan. And that idea that poverty humiliates is fundamental to Judaism. If you think about Birkat HaMazon, it's there in benching. Ribbono shel Olam, don't make us dependent on the gifts or loans of other people, but only on your full, open, and generous hand, so that we may neither suffer shame nor humiliation forever. So there is this insistence that we give in such a way that doesn't humiliate anyone, and that is the reason behind two remarkable laws. Here it is. Look at this. Afilu ani hamit parnes min hatzedakah chayav liten tzedakah. Even a poor person who can only live on the basis of tzedakah has to give tzedakah. Now go figure. You know, should I give money to A to give to B? I could give to B directly. Why do I need to give a poor person enough money so that he can give tzedakah? In economic terms, it makes no sense at all. But in psychological terms, it makes a great deal of sense. Because if I only receive and I don't give, I feel humiliated. Being able to give is an essential part of human dignity, and therefore we have to give enough to a poor person so that he too can give. Number two, the famous halacha, codified by the Rambam, that the highest degree of charity is to give somebody a gift or a loan, or accept him into a business partnership, or find him a job so that he can dispense with other people's aid. Now, you go figure. To give somebody a loan to start a business, that's not costing me anything. I'll get the money back. Whereas if I give lots of money to tzedakah, I'm hurting. I've given away a lot. So how come this is the highest form of charity? Answer, because you give somebody a job, help them start a business, then they no longer need to depend on tzedakah. And that shows that the essence of tzedakah is not only helping somebody physically, materially, but helping somebody psychologically as well. What the Rambam is doing here in the 12th century was recently rediscovered by somebody called Muhammad Yunus in Bangladesh, who, as you know, developed the Grameen Bank to provide poor people with micro loans, small loans, to help them start their own businesses, for which he was awarded the Nobel Prize. What Muhammad Yunus was doing was already what the Rambam told us 8 centuries earlier. The way to create a world without poverty is to help people start their own business or find them a job. And this remains still the most powerful, powerful form there is. What is remarkable about Judaism is Judaism refused to romanticize poverty. Many other religions said, oh, it's blessed to be poor. But Judaism said, no, it is nothing of the kind. Poverty is a humiliation. Poverty crushes the spirit. Poverty is not a blessed state, but a curse. Poverty is something that we have to try to eliminate, if at all possible. Because, said the Rambam, don't pretend that your mind can be full of noble spiritual thoughts when you don't have enough food to eat and you don't have a roof over your head. So first, eliminate poverty, and only then worry about people's spirituality, which is why I believe that all of us have to come together as religious leaders to argue against poverty and to fight it together, because that is the great human challenge. Friends, I still believe that Jewish teachings on poverty remain the most powerful of any great tradition anywhere in the world. And as we've seen in microloans, in debt relief and so on, still they are influencing relief efforts on behalf of the international community. Let us, by these Jewish teachings, make poverty history. Shabbat Shalom.